All right, Crystal, what's on your radar?
Well, while white-collar workers nestle at home with their laptops and their Uber Eats, the working class has been shoved onto the front lines of this crisis. For most of the working class, the coronavirus crisis has been a case of terrible or worse. Millions are, of course, losing their jobs outright, forced onto unemployment rolls, facing down rent, which is just days away, wondering what the future will ultimately hold for them. But millions more work in industries that are suddenly essential and absolutely slammed. Healthcare workers, grocery clerks, sanitation workers, warehouse workers, and more are being crushed with work. And as their employers reap massive profits, they're left with low wages, a grueling pace, and often unsafe and unsanitary conditions, leaving their families and their communities vulnerable. It's no accident that the neighborhoods in New York hardest hit by coronavirus also happen to be lower-income neighborhoods. A borough map of coronavirus cases shows wealthy Manhattan to be faring much better than the working-class neighborhoods of Queens, Brooklyn, and the Bronx. Makes sense, since those workers who aren't laid off are forced into the workplace, often with little or no protective gear to keep them and their families safe and healthy. Increasingly, though, those workers are not taking it quietly. Wildcat strikes and other workplace actions have spread across the nation, across industries and occupations. In New York on Monday, Amazon workers at a Staten Island warehouse walked out. Here's one Amazon worker explaining why she's striking.
My name is Heaven. And I walked out because Amazon lied. They told me there was one case in the building, and it's actually 11, so I don't feel safe.
Instacart workers nationwide walked down over similar concerns for their health and safety, no paid sick leave, and a lack of hazard pay to compensate them for the increased risk that they are taking. Today, Whole Foods workers are planning a sick out, demanding increased hazard pay, coronavirus testing, and paid sick leave. Nurses in Watsonville, California walked out. Sanitation workers in Pittsburgh, iron workers at a main shipyard, bus drivers in Birmingham, bus drivers in Detroit, warehouse workers in Memphis, a Fiat Chrysler truck plant in Michigan, McDonald's workers in California and Illinois, poultry workers in Georgia. As one of those Purdue chicken workers put it bluntly, we're not getting nothing. No type of compensation, no nothing, not even cleanliness, no extra pay, no nothing. We're up here risking our life for chicken. Think about this. These actions are happening at a time when individual workers are frankly more disposable in their employer's eyes than ever before. With millions filing for unemployment by the week, how hard would it be to get one of those newly laid off workers to come take the spot of your troublesome, rabble-rousing workforce with their unthinkable demands for paid sick leave and soap in the restroom? In fact, Amazon has already fired one of the organizers at their Staten Island warehouse. And in a frightening omen of how the current public health guidelines can be weaponized to stifle dissent, their stated justification was that the worker violated social distancing guidelines. These workers are showing real bravery and real solidarity with their brothers and sisters. At GE, workers actually protested the company's failure to retool to manufacture the ventilators that the country is in such desperate need of. Contrast that to banker Joel Friedman's unconscionable demand that Philly pay him $1 million a month to use the empty hospital he purchased recently, and you can see pretty clearly which side of the class war you morally want to be on. These actions are individually powerful and have already won important concessions from intransigent bosses. But as is always the case in America, the threat of starvation is real and it's powerful. Nothing focuses the mind and keeps workers in check like the fear of financial oblivion. Losing your home, getting kicked out of your apartment, being unable to provide for your family, and just the shame and stigma that comes from being poor in the home of the free. Unionized workers have more protections than their non-union brothers and sisters and at least have someone to fight for them. But plenty of them are being laid off with no hesitation right now as well. Ultimately, the only way for workers to have real power in their workplaces is for them to know for certain that they can take their labor elsewhere. The fundamental economic right to tell a bad boss to F off. This is true always, but it's especially true at a time when unemployment is set to jump perhaps as high as 30%. And so while a lot of policy conversation is rightly focused on how this crisis exposes the essential need for and foolishness of opposing Medicare for All, it should also focus our mind on another less heralded part of the Bernie Sanders platform, a federal jobs guarantee. Now, as I discussed previously, there's an immediate need right now for workers to be deployed and surged into certain critical areas like healthcare and sanitation and manufacturing essential items. These workers should be protected and they should be well paid for any attendant risks that they take. But there's also just a massive need to put a floor under the economic fallout that we're witnessing. Just as we had a Works Progress Administration, not to mention a world war, directly employing Americans, we need a modern jobs program to help sustain our workers in the short term and to shift power to American workers in the long term. Crazy idea. I don't know. Doesn't seem any crazier to me than propping big business up with $4 trillion. In fact, it seems infinitely more sane than that. Crazy to imagine it could happen? I don't know. General strike is trending on Twitter, and workers across the country are already speaking up and walking out in anger over the daily risks and indignities they're made to suffer. But at a fundamental level, that their lives would be treated as more trivial than the need for next-day delivery or freezer cases fully stocked with chicken nuggets. Seems to me like the time to act is right now. Time to stand in solidarity with a list of demands that goes beyond individual workplaces, across party lines, and stands for nothing more or less than acknowledging and actualizing the individual worth and dignity of every single worker. Sagar, when I started doing research for this, I'd been following the workplace actions across the country, but I was even stunned by the number that have been popping up in city and state after state across industries, workers who are individually coming together in solidarity and saying, you know what, our lives matter and you need to take them seriously.
It's mystifying to me that they don't, like, how is Amazon, which prints money off of its server business, not just giving these people what they need, at least personal protective equipment or a $2 rate, whatever, like whatever they're right. demanding, especially when you said they need them now more than ever. I'm always struck by how obtuse some of these like corporate masters seem in times like this, because they'll demand and let strife like this fester when it's like, guys, the entire economy is on the line. You need them a lot more than they need you at this point.
Right.
I mean, and that's really what it fundamentally comes down to, which is that Amazon is going to be a joke if they're not going to be able to fulfill orders. That's like the core of their business. Just pay these people what they need.
Right.
And I mean, and it's obvious that they have the money and they're focusing all the strife, and they don't understand, which I think we do, the longer you let this stuff go on, and if you fire the guy, quash strikes, all of that, if you don't give in to some of this stuff, you are going to be setting the ground for the government to actually come in and redistribute some of their wealth
yep.
when the time comes. I'm not saying it'll happen in this crisis. Could be 2 years, 3 years. That's what happened. I mean, I've been reading and thinking a lot about the history of the New Deal and all that. And people forget that four-year period where nothing was really done in the Hoover administration. Stuff like this was happening, but 10 scale.
Yes.
I mean, people were like literally like killing lawyers who were foreclosing on houses and things. And people had to come in and set up some sort of social infrastructure because the bottom was about to fall out of the American, like, of American society.
Yeah.
I'm not saying we're there yet.
No.
But, like, but this is how it begins.
You don't even have to take it back that far. You know, I followed and covered the teachers' movement really closely, and the way that that started was with individual counties taking their own actions, which were technically illegal in the state of West Virginia, wildcat strikes. And then once that model was set, it spread across West Virginia, it spread across the country. And so these things can catch on very quickly and very unexpectedly. I think there's also just what you see right now is this incredible glaring mismatch between the reality of how critical and essential these workers actually are. Like, they are literally the people who make the country run, while white collar workers could basically, like, their jobs could go away and no one would even notice, right? But these people, the country runs on their labor, so they're absolutely critical and essential, especially during this time. And on the other hand, they're treated by the country and by society, and certainly by their bosses and employers writ large, as disposable. Mm-hmm. As, we don't need you, we don't want you, your life is worth less than getting this chicken processed right now. That's what the Amazon workers' main concern is. Yes, it's pay, and they should be well paid for the amount of work, the increased workload, and also the increased risk that they're taking right now. But it's also the fact, you saw Heaven there talking about why she was protesting. There were multiple people who have tested positive for coronavirus working at warehouse facilities across the country, and they do not feel that that has been taken seriously in terms of shutting those distribution centers down, making sure that they're clean so that nobody is at risk, because you're talking about people. I mean, their job is literally to be touching these packages.
The virus lives on cardboard boxes.
Yes, and so it's they're just asking for the basic right of take my life seriously. Mm-hmm. Take it more seriously than your bottom line, than having your next day delivery, than, you know, making sure the chicken nuggets are processed on time. Like, take that seriously. It's something that is so basic and yet often, especially during this crisis, completely dismissed and overlooked. We talked to the Teamster
yes.
who was talking about the UPS delivery and package handlers and how in the bathrooms there, you know, we're all supposed to be washing our hands and sanitation and not just for our own sakes, but for the good of the community. They're even running water in the bathroom. Like, that's what we're talking about.
And
here.
This is, look, this everybody knows this. We were criticizing any government effort in order to try and reopen the, because we're like, hey, listen, you know what? We'll really crash the economy. And if everybody got sick, well, it's the same thing with business. If you don't take care of your workforce now, then you're going to have no workers. I mean, we're already seeing this happen in the healthcare industry with the lack of protective equipment. The amount of healthcare workers are skyrocketing in the number of coronavirus crises. So Amazon is not going to be able to send out products if their warehouses get full of coronavirus.
Right.
Probably makes sense from a business perspective. Shut down.
True.
You know,
it's just
clean it all out. It's just the short-termist, like, efficiency mindset. Like, no. We have to get everything out for one day. It's like, people can wait a day for laundry detergent, but you can't, you know, you might have to wait weeks if an entire warehouse goes down. So even from a business perspective, it just doesn't make any sense. But that's how so much of these people think. And again, I just think they're really missing about the social strife that can bubble up in these times, because
right.
if you force people to work in dangerous conditions for, you know, day after day, month after month, and all of that, you are going to have a reckoning. I don't know if it'll come this time, but nobody forgets what somebody forces them to work in a warehouse where you could get coronavirus.
Right.
That is like...
Right. Well, but in bottom line, for these workers are so courageous. I mean, like I pointed out, Amazon organizer already fired.
Right. They fired him, yeah.
That should be illegal, but it happens all the time in America.
Well, he has to prove it, right?
Right, yeah. Exactly. And the NLRB in this town is basically more or less defunct and a totally corporatist. But, you know, real power comes from knowing you have another option.
Yeah.
Knowing you can walk out. Knowing you can get another job. And so I think as we look at the long term and think about moving forward, that's something, that power dynamic is very much to keep front of mind. Sagar, looking forward to your radar. That's next.